Y'all know what that is, a June bug. Y'all know, no. Y'all know I can't dance, but it is super. Oh yeah, how you doing? But anyway, it's Super Bowl Sunday. We about to get this dub, you already know. And for those of you guys who are watching me and you are not Chiefs fans, please do not mistake our confidence for arrogance. We are still new to this. We are still new to this. If you have been a Chiefs fan for any length of time, you know you have had your heart broken several times. And so please don't compare us to Patriots fans or Yankees fans or Celtics fans. We are not used to this. So we are still happy about winning, and we are going to get the win today because we have the best player in the world on our team, Patrick LeVon Mahomes II. Now, I'm not worshiping him. I do love him, though. I do love him. Praise God, I love him, but I'm not worshiping him. I'm excited to be here. I'm not going to hold you long. Today, I'm going to finish the notes from last week, all right? The last focus, which is cultivating a life of confession, an atmosphere of confession, a culture of confession in your life. I'm going to finish those notes. Before I do, I told you that I was going to reveal unto you, yes, unto thee, I was going to reveal unto thee the Vision Day theme for this season. Now, mind you, you need to understand what Vision Day is. Vision Day is super important because it gives us the room. It gives us the audacity. It gives us the resources to be able to do the things that I feel the Lord is calling our church to do in this season entitled 2021. All right? And so, like I said, one of those things is to make sure that we are resourced enough that when the Lord highlights a particular property for us, we are able to move on that thing without any type of hindrances. Now, I'm expecting some type of opposition from the devil because I know the devil, but I don't want that opposition to be financial. Somebody say amen. Amen. Right. And so you guys are going to help us do that. We're going to raise a whole bunch of money for that. And we're also going to raise a whole bunch of money for our Next Gen department. Let's give it up for Next Gen. Come on. Now, what is Next Gen, you may ask? Next Gen is our City Kids, our Verge, and our Swerve. It is our community of youth, and we are wanting to pour into them. And one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to appoint some leadership over them. And not only are we going to appoint some leadership, we're going to pay the leadership to lead. Somebody say amen to that. Not only are we going to pay the leadership to lead, but we're going to make sure the leadership gets the education they need to be able to lead effectively. Come on. That costs money. Somebody say amen. And so we're going to come together and we're going to fund that. Why? Because we believe the children are our future. But anyway, we're going to do that. I'm excited. So I want you to give. I want some of you guys to join me. Give $1,000 that day. If you're watching me and you're a millionaire, God bless you. God bless you. And we know that if you got 99 problems and money ain't one, shorty, swing our way. Bring that on over here and help us do what God has called us to do. Now, let me drop the theme real quick. You ready? Yeah. The theme for Vision Day this year and the theme for this year and beyond until I change my mind, until the Lord comes down and says, change it. And I change it. It is don't stop believing. Let me hear you say, don't stop believing. Let me see you type, don't stop believing. All right, doggone it, type it up. Don't stop believing. We're not going to stop holding on to the promises of God. We're not going to stop believing for greater. We're not going to stop believing that the vision shall come to pass. We're not going to stop believing that the Lord has made room for us. We just ain't walked into it yet, all right? So don't stop believing, all right? So remember that when you give every week, not just Vision Day. Come on. Like, somebody say every week.
Every week.
All right, man, we need that, all right? Let's go, all right. Let's get into this. Let's go to James chapter 5, verse 16. James chapter 5, verse 16. I'm going to finish these notes off, and we're going to go watch this game and eat some. I think I'm eating fish today. It may be fried. Mind your business. I got a little room to spare. Mind your business. But I'm going to eat some fish. I'm going to watch this game. And the office already knows. If so happen the Chiefs lose. Some of them are here right now. If the Chiefs lose, don't show up to work. I don't want to see you. I don't want to talk to you. Don't call me. Don't text me. If they win, I want to see you. I love you. We can be best friends, and we're going to have a party here at the office. So they already know the office is going to be closed, so don't call up here. We don't care. We don't care. All right? If something happens, call Jesus. All right? James 5:16 says, Therefore, confess your sins one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Now, I'm not going to spend time on the prayer aspect, but y'all know we talked about the confession aspect. The prayer of a righteous person has great power in his work. So this is part two of cultivating a life of confession, an atmosphere of confession, a culture of confession in your life. And a lot of you were really blessed by that. And let me say how blessed I am that you're blessed. That I have a church filled with people who love the word of God. That takes pressure off of a pastor right there. If you just love the word of God, you know what I mean? And so I appreciate you. So that's what we're going to look at. We're going to finish these notes out and we're going to look about that. Okay. So when we talk about confession, there are a lot of different images. There are a lot of different pictures that we see. Like, so what about these images that we have about confession? Like for me, I like to watch true crime stories or The First 48. Y'all like The First 48? You ever watch The First 48? Sometimes I feel bad for people, guilty people, that I really shouldn't feel bad for. You did it. Your DNA was there, but I feel bad. And the only time I usually feel bad is when they're in something called the interrogation room, right? And the cops come in there. God bless the police. But the cops come in there and act like they're their best friend. Listen, Johnny, I love you. Just tell me what happened. I want to help you. And I'll be on the other side of the TV like, Johnny, he don't want to help you. Don't talk. All you got to do is shut up. Because the police are trained that if I get a what? Confession, it'll make the case move smoothly. But that's not the type of confession I'm talking about. God is not waiting for you to walk into this interrogation room where he's interrogating you and he's coercing you, right, to make this confession and to admit that you did something. But so what is confession? One thing you got to understand is this. Confession is not telling God something he doesn't know. Right? So when the police officer says, Johnny, I know what you did, they may not really know what Johnny did. Like, that has worked on my kids. Amaris, namely. She's probably watching this right now. That works on Amaris all the time. I just gave it away. Doggone it. But I'll be like, Amaris, I know what you did. Just tell me now and save yourself the trouble. Okay. And you know what I'm saying? And then she'll confess it. But this is not what God is doing. It's not telling God something he doesn't know. Right. The scripture says that the eyes of the Lord see everything. Right. The scripture says that God already knows what you have need of when before you ask. So what is confession? Here it is. Here's a biblical view and perspective of what confession is. It is pouring yourself out to God. Confession is acknowledging the transforming grace of God. Confession is throwing yourself on the mercy of God. So what it is, it's saying, God, I know you know because you know everything. So I'm not telling you anything in my heart or anything in my life that you don't know. What I'm doing is acknowledging the fact that you know, and I'm acknowledging the fact that only you can deal with this. So honestly, confession of sin before God is an act of worship. It's acknowledging that God is the only person who can really deal with this. It's acknowledging that God is the only person who can really heal this. It's, I am in constant need of your forgiveness, God. Does anybody understand what I'm saying? It is God, you are the only person who can fix me. I'm broken. Other things have tried to fix me. They have failed. I've tried to find fulfillment elsewhere. It has failed. You are the only one. That is an act of worship. So the culture of confession in your life is one of the biggest indicators of how you view God. The culture or the atmosphere or the climate of confession in your life is one of the biggest indications of how you view God. And most people don't realize this, Daisy. Most people don't realize it is that your approach to God reveals your perspective of God. I remember growing up and I lived in a strict household. I wasn't going to admit nothing. My parents was going to have to catch me. They was going to have to catch me in a lie. Like I wasn't, I, I fight tooth and nail. Do stuff like change my report card, just all kind of stuff. Right, yeah, I was bad. Back then we had answering machines, wasn't no voicemail. It was you could get home before your parents and hit delete and erase it, all right? So your approach to God reveals your perspective of God. If you see God as the punisher, as the mean old man, you're not going to bring him anything, even if you know he already knows. It's not going to be a culture in your life to confess to God, to say, God, help me with this. So the question is, are y'all still with me? So the question is, how should we see him? How should we see him? Let's look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. It says this in the New Living Translation. It says, 1 John 1 and 9, you know this. It says, but if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just. Underline that in your Bible. Faithful and just. Underline that. Those are two key words to understand the gravity, the gravitas, the effectiveness, the potency of this text. He is faithful and just to do what? To forgive our sins and do what else? Cleanse us of all what? So scripture uses two words here. It uses the word faithful. And then, Lene, it couples the word faithful with the word just. Okay? Uses two words that are super important. Like if you just read this, you'll miss it. But if you slow down and you read it, you'll understand how important it is. So it uses two words. It says, confess your sins. Why? Why I got to? Because God is faithful. And then it says just. Now, this is extremely important. So you got to ask yourself, why is this important? First, you go back to the beginning, the A clause of verse 9 in chapter 1, John, 1 John chapter 1. It says, if we confess. Everybody say that. If we confess. Come on, say it. If we confess. Now, if we confess, this is key. Because this doesn't mean we aren't already forgiven if we don't confess. Doesn't mean that. We know that forgiveness was accomplished where? On Calvary. When Jesus said it is finished and you confess that Jesus is Lord, that confession was made unto salvation. You're totally forgiven, past, present, and future. If we receive the gospel, we understand by faith we are ultimately forgiven. But this does mean that since sin is a real thing and it has not gone away and I'm still housed in sinful flesh, it still has the ability to affect my relationship with God. Did you hear what I said? It has the ability to affect my relationship with others, and it has the ability to affect my relationship with God. It can still get in there. It can still block me from blessing. But I'm forgiven though. Like, this is why there are so many defeated believers who believe but are defeated, because sin in their life, it can still cloud things for you. Still cloud your view, your perspective. It can mess up the connection and the relationship that you have with God. Watch this. Just on your end. Now, it does nothing to God's love for you. It does nothing with God's willingness to communicate with you, with his willingness to embrace you, with his willingness to forgive you. All that is just flowing from God. Just flowing. Boom, boom, boom. Like your cell phone signal. Just flowing. Like cell phone signals don't necessarily drop. I mean, there are signals everywhere, radio signals and cell phone signals, boom, boom, boom. Something happens with that signal reaching your device. And so there's nothing wrong with the signal. There's something wrong with the device. Same thing goes with confession. The device is clouded. The device is messed up. The device is going through something. The device, I'm the device. So in this light, confession becomes a weapon to protect your relationship with God as the Holy Spirit guides you to truth and out of sin. So write that down. Confession becomes a weapon. You got to look at it like that. Hating on yourself is one of the biggest weapons that hell can't stand. Right? Hell can't stand it. Remember what Satan came and told God? Have you? And God said, have you considered my servant Job? What did Satan say? Yeah. The only reason he's serving you is because of all these blessings and provisions and this hedge of protection that you put on him. Remove that and he gonna curse you. Job's wife said, your confession needs to be to curse God and die. Job said, foolish woman, I'm not about to curse the one who blessed me. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And so we see that confession becomes a weapon. How? Because it protects your relationship with Jesus as the Holy Spirit guides you in truth out of sin. Let's look at John chapter 16, verse 13. Are y'all still with me? Y'all on the thing. Are y'all still with me? Don't play with me now. YouTube, y'all be just watching me on TV and don't say nothing. Are y'all with me? Let's look at it. John 16, verse 13. When the Spirit of truth comes, or the Holy Spirit, okay, he will guide you into all truth. What will he do? What will he do? Why? How? Because he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will declare you the things that are to come. And so this is what the Holy Spirit does when he confronts you about sin in your life. He's guiding you into truth. That's God's purposes. That's why confession is so important, because God wants you to live in the light. And in 1 John, it says those who are in the light are of the light. And so the Holy Spirit's job is to take the words of Jesus and march your butt right up out of that dark place. To take your hand and say, no, baby girl, you're living a lie right now. You're believing a lie. You're living a lie. Let's come on up out of this and let's walk toward the truth. Now, I know the truth may hurt for a second. I know the truth may offend you for a second. I know the truth sometimes sounds worse than the lie. But in the end of the day, the truth is always going to outlast the lie. The lie is in your life to destroy you. The truth is in your life to build you. The Holy Spirit's job with confession is to lead you out of that. Let's look at Proverbs 28, verse 13. Y'all with me? Proverbs 28, verse 13. If you cover up your sin, you'll never do well. But if you confess your sin and forsake them, you will be kissed by mercy. There's somebody watching me right now who's wondering why they cannot get ahead. Why things won't connect? It's because you are too important to God for him to allow you to have success in a lie. Well, other people can do it according to your definition of success. There's never any success when you conceal sin. If you cover up sin, you'll never do well. That's why confession is important. God understands, you are my people, I love you. You are called by my name, I bless you. I have saved you, I have raised you up. Your responsibility is to live in the light and not to wallow in the darkness through a lie. So if you cover up your sin that I know is there, that you know I know is there, you'll never do well. I will keep a roadblock in front of you. I'll keep a cross. I will keep a wall in front of you until you confess and realize that I'm the only one who can deal with what you think success is going to fix. So this means, are y'all with me? This means, Quincy, Eddie, this means that one of your greatest weapons against the enemy in your life is to simply acknowledge as true what the Holy Spirit holds up and highlights. That's it. Somebody like, that's too easy. Yes, it is. Because the Holy Spirit is the one, and I'm going there, who does all the heavy lifting. The Holy Spirit does all the searching. The Holy Spirit does all the excavating and the digging. Our job is to say, since you found that in me, and you say what you found in me is sin, then I agree with what you say. No matter how it makes me feel, no matter how I think it makes me look, no matter how much of me I've given myself to it. If you say this is sin, I agree with you and I'm turning away from it. So confession is, it's the Holy Spirit walking into your life saying, yeah, We're going to have to talk about this. Now, you know. Now, the Holy Spirit doesn't condemn you. He's so loving. He says, yeah, you know this is keeping you from experiencing the fullness of God in your life, right? So I'm going to hold this up for you, and I'm going to highlight this for you, and I'm going to empower you to say what I'm saying about it. So that's what confession is. And so 1 John 1:9 begins with confession and then tells you why confession leads to forgiveness. It says, because God is faithful, and I'm getting there, and just. So it starts with confession, and I just broke that down. But then it says why confession leads to forgiveness is because God is faithful and just. And so this is how we should see God, as faithful and just. Faithful meaning he's going to do exactly what he said, and just meaning he's going to do what is deserved. Now watch, this is the point that, what does this mean though? Because you're like, do what it deserves. Okay, you with me? You gotta get this, all right? You have to grab hold to the fact that faithfulness and justice both need objects to show itself to. I'm going somewhere. For example, a man can't say he's faithful to his wife if he doesn't have a wife to be faithful to. It's plain, right? A judge can't say he judged a case justly if he's never had a case to judge. So for the simple fact that this text says God forgives us based on the fact that he's faithful and just, then the question has to be in this context, then who is he faithful and just to? Is the answer, is he faithful and just to us? Yes, in a sense. But in this context, for the simple fact that the text says God is just, and from what we know about the penalty of sin suggests that if God claims to be just, then that means he still has to deal with sin. And the just way to deal with sin, according to scripture, is death. This means forgiveness can't belong to us if the price of sin isn't paid for. I'm going somewhere. So this object of his faithfulness and justice can't be us in this context. We reap the benefits of it, but it can't be solely on me. So then who is God faithful and just to according to this context? The answer is Jesus. And since the scripture says in Isaiah that it pleased the Father to crush his son on the cross, this means in forgiving us and cleansing us, he is being faithful to his word and acting justly because his own wrath has been satisfied by his own hand. Which means the Father, in faithfulness to his word, gave the Son the judgment we deserve so that we can have the forgiveness we don't deserve. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The Father, in faithfulness to his word, gave the Son the judgment we deserve so we can have the forgiveness from confession that we don't deserve. So when we confess our sin, forgiveness is available to us based on the Father being faithful and just in light of Jesus. So confession of sin is a huge theme in scripture. For example, the parable of Jesus told about the prodigal son. Remember, the prodigal son said, he came and confessed and said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. And the scripture says that the father restored him, gave him a ring, gave him a robe, and threw him a party. Another story, Jesus tells about the Pharisee, a parable. Jesus tells about the Pharisee and the tax collector. The tax collector comes in there and is like, Father, forgive me, I'm a sinner. I ain't worthy, but please forgive me, I'm a sinner. But the Pharisee walked in there and started thanking God that he wasn't like the tax collector. Thank you, God, I'm not like him. I'm great. I'm awesome. I'm perfect. So we see confession is a theme in scripture. And then we also see, and I'm getting to my point, we all know King David. King David, and I'm getting to what I want to talk about. Remember the instance in King David where King David should have been fighting with his army? But instead of going to fight with his army, he woke up one day and said, you know what? I ain't got the fight. I'm going to let them handle that for me. I'm going to just go out on my balcony and look at my kingdom. He went on his balcony, looked at his kingdom, saw a bad girl bathing. Her name was Bathsheba. Bathsheba was bad and she was taking a bath. And David said, listen, I want that bathing Bathsheba. Bring her to me here, boy. Bring her to me. So he comes and he uses his authority to sleep with her. He sleeps with her. He gets her pregnant. Then, to cover it up, he tries to get her husband to sleep with her. So her husband can say, so her husband can think it's his baby. But the husband had more integrity than the king and said, I'm supposed to be fighting. I'm not about to get my freak on with my wife while I'm supposed to be out helping my men do what I need to do. So that didn't work. So David said, oh, okay, I know what I'm going to do. Hey, put him on the front line of the army so I can guarantee he dies. Instead of confessing, he's covering up. But then David is confronted by the prophet Nathan about his sin. But listen to what David says about the sin he had been holding in and suppressing and not confessing, because it took a while for David to get to the place of confession. But let's look and see what David was saying while he was holding in this sin in his life. And this is where picking up from where we left off. Psalm 38, 1 through 8. O Lord, Psalm 38, 1 through 8. O Lord, don't rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your rage. Your arrows have struck deep and your blows are crushing me. Because of your anger, my whole body is sick. My health is broken because of my sins. My guilt overwhelms me. It is a burden too heavy to bear. My wounds fester and stink because of my foolish sins. I am bent over and racked with pain. All day long, I walk around filled with grief. A raging fever burns within me. My health is broken. I am exhausted and completely crushed. My groans come from an anguished heart. Now jump down to verse 17 and 18 in 38, Psalm 38. Are y'all with this? You see what he's saying? He holding in all this sin. He holding in all this guilt. He's holding in all of this unprocessed, unconfessed sin, suppressed sin. Jump down to 17 and 18. Then he says, I am on the verge of collapse, facing constant pain. But I confess my sins. I'm deeply sorry for what I've done. So this is what I started to touch on last week that I want to kind of touch on this weekend concerning the correlation between confession and healing. We see with David, there's a suppression of sin, and we see, according to him, it has caused a physical reaction. But this is not always the case. I got to say that. Sometimes it is, though. And the best way I can illustrate as to why this is or how this works is this story that I heard several days ago. It's a story of this Chinese guy, okay? I think it happened like back in 2014. So this guy is in the alley. He's walking from somewhere and he gets attacked. And the person comes up behind him and like he thought hit him in his jaw. This is crazy. Now listen to me. He thought he was hitting the jaw. So he gets robbed. He falls out. He's knocked out and he gets robbed. And he's like, oh, my God, what's going on? So for a couple years after that, he just starts having these horrible migraines. This is a trip story. Like I'm going to show y'all the picture. So he's having these terrible headaches to where he's debilitated. He can't walk. He can't move. Breathing problems. He's constantly going to the doctor. The doctor's like, man, here, take this medicine, blah, 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 blah. Come to find out, he finally gets an x-ray. Come to find out what he thought was just a punch in the jaw. Somehow, I have no idea how, y'all. They don't even know. Somehow he was stabbed in the head. How they missed this, I don't know. It's a real article. You can find it. How they missed it, I don't know. There was a 4-inch long knife that started from like his jaw and went up into his head. Missed everything. Like it inserted like through his mouth and went through like the nose. Like it was such a perfect swipe that there was no blood, no nothing, but the handle broke off. That's how he didn't know he was stabbed. And so he had been living with this foreign object in his body that was causing him pain. And I was reading that story and something jumped out to me. And I feel like the Holy Spirit was like, we're not created to live with foreign objects in our bodies or in our souls. So that foreign object was causing sickness in his body. That foreign object was causing pain that he didn't even know was going on. And I feel like what the Lord is trying to communicate is that we were not designed to live. And what would a spiritual x-ray reveal? Oh, it's lodged inside of you that's causing issues you may not even realize. If the Spirit of God was to do an x-ray on you, what would we see? Would we see an insurmountable amount of guilt, unforgiveness, sin, this lust, this addiction? So what happened was is the doctors had to go in and get it out. And as believers, we have to know that the Holy Spirit is willing to perform surgery. And he uses the word of God, which is why it is called the sword of the Spirit. Or remember I taught y'all the sword that the Spirit uses. This is why confession is key, because you are literally saying with every cut from God's word that you get, I needed that. God, I needed that cut. I needed that rebuke. I needed that correction. God, I needed to be slapped in the face with that scripture today. This is why it's important to have a relationship with the sword of the Spirit. Because the sword of the Spirit is the one who will begin to reveal the deep setting stuff that you may not even realize is deeply implanted into your heart. And so David, the same David who suppressed sin, the same David who at first refused to confess, is the same David in Psalm 139. Let's look at that real quick. 139, 23. He says, search me, O God. And this is where I'm about to jump off this train. Search me, ooh, y'all. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. God, that spoke to me, my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you. And lead me along the path of everlasting life. Somebody say, search me, O God. Search. That word in Hebrew means penetrate. Or watch this. It means to sound. That's a good word. You can write that down. The word sound is a word used in aquatics or diving when dealing with testing the depth of the ocean. The same word we get in 1 Corinthians where it says the Spirit searcheth. God, it searches the deep things of God. That word searcheth there is he sounds the deep things of God. He knows the depths of God. He knows how deep God is. So when David says, search me, O God, he's saying sound. It's like sonar. If you know anything about animals, bats use this too. They're blind. So they use sound to detect the depth of something to see. And so it's when the boat releases a sound and then measures the depth of it by how it comes back and how long the sound takes to get back to where it was sent. Y'all know where I'm going. I got a crowd in here. And so David says, search me now. Sound, release something in me, God, and see how it comes. David asked God to search him, meaning see what you get back from me. See if what you get back from me resembles what you put in me. Y'all not, y'all, who am I talking to? Sound me, God. That's what David meant. Search me. Penetrate me. Release something. See how it comes back to you. Can we admit to somebody who's watching me right now who ain't been giving God back nothing he been giving to you? You ain't been giving him no worship. You ain't been giving him no praise. You ain't been giving him no attention. You ain't been giving him the gifting that he put in you. You ain't giving back. And so David said, God, what you released to me got to come back to you the same way. God, see if you see me. See if you see you in me. That's what that means. Search me. See if it comes back in it, and it's the same way you sent it. God, release a sound in your heart. Be honest. How has it come back to him? How has the sound of love come back to him? Has it come back in complaining? God released the sound of love, but has it come back to him in anger or complaining or grumbling or ungratefulness? So David said, God, you're going to have to search me, penetrate me, sound, release something. Because confession is an invitation for God to see his reflection. Confession is an invitation for God to see his reflection. It's I want to be free from this sin that is marring your image in me. I want to be free from this sin. I want to throw off of me this weight that is messing up the light I'm supposed to be shining in the earth. But David didn't stop at search me, and I'm not either. After search me, he said, test me. Somebody say, test me. It's the same word used when a blacksmith refines metal. And the way you do it is you get it real hot. And you turn up the heat, and the heat will do the separating. And all the impurities will come to the surface. And the refiner will begin to sweep off the impurities so he can only work with that which is pure. What did David say? David said, test me. I'm going to test you. Turn the heat up. Put me in some fire. Put me in a hot situation. Some of y'all like, God, don't do it. But if you think back over your life, the best seasons of your life was the hardest ones. The best seasons of your life were the ones where you couldn't stand the heat. But God kept you in that fire because he knew that was the only way he was going to get that stuff out of you. Blessing couldn't get it out of you. Favor couldn't get it out of you. Money couldn't get it out of you. Hardship got it out of you. Craziness got it out of you. The heat got it out of you. And that stuff surfaced, and God was able to wipe it clean and present you unto himself as a purified vessel. And so David says, search me, test me. And the last word he uses, see. He said, see if there's anything. He says, point it out. It's a prophetic Hebrew word. And it doesn't just require, it doesn't just mean God is seeing something, right? Like I can see it, right? Because I can see something in you and not be able to do anything about it, right? You ever been able just to identify a problem with somebody? Like, you know what? He real. He trash. Girl, what's wrong with him? He's selfish. But how can I make him be less selfish? Right, this is a lot of issues even in our marriages. We identify the issues in our spouses, and we think that we can also be the solution to the issue. That I can make you do what you're lacking. That's not this type of see. This is a prophetic see. This implies God is seeing an area to fill an area. You hear what I'm saying? So when David's saying, see if there's something in me that offends you, David is literally asking God to find any place in his heart and life that God is not filling, and then fill it. What do you mean? Search me. See if there's something there that offends you. What offends him? The fact that we're using something to fill a place only he can. That's offensive to God. Like, how is this person taking my place? That's what he means. See, point it out. And once you point it out, remove it, and you step right in there. And that's what most of us need. We're missing the point. That when we're asking God to see if it's something in us that's not like him, we pray that, God, see if it's something in me and take it out, Lord Jesus. And we don't even really know what we're saying. What we're saying is, God, once you see something in me that's not supposed to be there, remove it, and then you step in his place. Which means I need to be satisfied with you. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. God says, I'm offended that you're using that thing as a filler when that thing isn't enough. I am. So this is the power of confession. The power of confession is search me. The power of confession is test me. And the power of confession is point it out. Search me, sound. See if what you sinned is coming back to you the way you sent it. Test me. Turn the heat up in my life, God, and get rid of these impurities. And then point it out. See it, which means prophetically look into me, God, and see if there's an area in my life that I think is functioning great, but it's not functioning great because you're not in it. And remove that thing and fill it. In Jesus' name. And so those are my notes. That's it. I'm at the end. I can give you some practical tips on how to confess. Right, real quick. Confess to. Here you go. Confess to someone trustworthy. Don't just walk around just confessing to people who you don't know. Right? I just need to confess my sins. If you're dating somebody, like, don't bombard them with that. Find a leader, a pastor, a spouse, a trustworthy person you want to be able to confess to. Number two, you don't want to confess to someone who is suffering through the same aspect of temptation and sin as you are, right? Like, is you and this one dude, or you, this one girl, if you're a guy, and you're like, can you come to my house real quick? I need to confess something to you. I really been lusting after you. I want to do some things to you. And I just felt like the Lord is calling me to just get this off my chest. Because what they say, I've been having the same kind of doing some things too. You know what I'm saying? No. What am I talking about? But just practical stuff, right? You want to make sure, you have to be careful not to confess something, especially a sexual sin, to someone who's weak in that area too. That's why it's important to develop a relationship with leadership and make sure you know that you're safe and there's not somebody that will take advantage of that particular confession. The last one is related to all those, with wisdom, right? You ask the Holy Spirit. You follow His leadership. You want to confess with wisdom, right? You want to confess with wisdom, right? And you ask God for wisdom. The scripture says He'll give it to you liberally. He'll just give you more than what you need, all right? And so those are the three little things I want to give you. Listen, I love you. I want to pray for you right now. That you begin to just cultivate that atmosphere, that life, that climate of confession in your life. And I want to pray for you. Can we pray? Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come before you right now, Father, and I pray for these, your sheep, your people, God, who you love dearly. Oh, God, we know that there's power in confession, that confession is what gives you the invitation to see your reflection in us, God, that we are willing to ask you to remove the things that are marring or tainting your image being seen in us, the light shining in the earth. And so, Father, we know that that's not going to be necessarily easy for some of us, because some of the things we need to confess are things we feel give us the advantage. And so, Father, we pray that we never look at sin as something that gives us the advantage, but that always removes us out of your perfect plan and always puts a blockade between us and a right relationship with you. And so, Father, I pray right now that we would develop a tenacity for confession. That, God, not because we don't believe we're already forgiven, but because we believe we are forgiven. And we don't want anything to come in between the relationship we have with you. And so, Father, we want to not be a house for a foreign object. We don't want to be a house for guilt. That don't belong in our body. We don't want to be a house for sin. That doesn't belong in our life. We don't want to be a house for all of these foreign objects that you have set us free from through the gospel. But we want to be a free house, a house that's filled with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. God, I pray that you invade that house right now. That you invade that house right now, God. That you would give them the courage, and not just the courage, but you would give them the relationship, the comfort, the safety that they need to get some stuff out of their soul. God, it is making somebody who's watching me ill. God, the pain in their body, God. I'm not saying all pain is related to unconfessed sin, but there are instances in scripture where some pain is. And the scripture says to call forth for the elders. And so, Father, right now, somebody is calling forth right now. And so, Father, I pray the prayer of faith over them right now. God, I pray that you would heal their body, that you would heal their mind. I pray that the wind of healing would go into their homes right now in the name of Jesus and touch what every area needs to be touched. In Jesus' name, right now, I pray against that demonic stronghold that is trying to keep them bound, that is trying to keep them disabled, that is trying to keep them stricken. And Father, I pray that you will release the freedom of heaven right now in that house, the freedom of heaven right now in their mind, in the name of Jesus. I believe it. You said the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. God, I believe what I'm praying. I believe it right now, and I believe that healing is coming to somebody who's watching me. As a matter of fact, whoever it is that your body is being touched right now, I want you to email me. Email me at stories@thecitykc.com. I want to hear it because I know God is touching somebody right now. I want to hear it. Email me at stories@thecitykc.com. Somebody's going to put it up on the screen for you. Because I believe the Spirit of God is touching you right where you. Some of you right now, there's been an ailment on you and you didn't even know where it was coming. It just came out of the blue and you've been suffering with it. And you've gone from doctor to doctor to doctor to doctor and nobody has seemed to help you. I'm here to tell you that foreign objects aren't meant to live into you, in your body. There may be something deep down lodged in your heart that you need to present before the Lord, and not just confess before the Lord, but you may need to confess before other people the things that you've been harboring and holding on to. And I pray that healing begins to invade your life right now. Hallelujah. Come on, I need those of you in here to begin to pray. Hallelujah. I believe it right now. Right now, I believe it. I believe it right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray that you will release a healing power from your hand to begin to swallow up that disease right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. The power of confession is real. The power of confession is real. Just tell him he already knows. Just tell him right now. Just open your mouth and start telling him right now. Right now. Come on. Right now. Right now. Just tell him. You watching me right now. Ooh, hallelujah. In Jesus' name. I want you to email me because I know he's touching you right now. Whatever it is, I want you to email me. stories@thecitykc.com. Listen. Father, we pray these things in your son Jesus' name. Listen, if you're here and you want to know Jesus, click this link. Somebody's going to lead you to the Lord and tell you what it means to serve and follow Jesus. Listen, I love you. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer as always. And go Chiefs. I'll see you soon.